The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Michael Maria Delgado is a certified cat behavior consultant. She's worked full-time as a cat behavior specialist at the San Francisco SPCA. She's also founded Feline Minds, which I'm reading her bio from felineminds.com. She's been featured in Cat Fancy, The New York Times, Slate, and The Huffington Post. And I read about her this week in The Washington Post. She comes to us today from Berkeley, California, Michael Maria Delgado. Hello, Michael.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thank you for doing this. You're currently a PhD candidate at UC Berkeley in the psychology department.
That's right. I am wrapping up and hope to be a doctor by next year.
Okay, Dr. Delgado, may I say that?
It's a little, I don't want to jinx it.
I have so much to ask you, but is YouTube changing the way people like you are learning about cats?
I wouldn't say it's necessarily changing how we learn about cats, but it's changing how we share information about cats. I think the problem with YouTube is that there's a wide range of quality in what's getting posted on there. I think a lot of people are just trying to make their cat famous, and so they're trying some wacky things like dressing their cat up in a costume or, you know, making their cat play drums. Those kinds of things are not necessarily beneficial to cats as pets. But on the other hand, cats are getting a lot of attention. They're naturally cute. People are becoming obsessed, like you. So I think overall that could have benefits, like increasing the number of cats who are adopted, because now everybody thinks cats are cool.
Well, cats are cool, but did you ever see something on YouTube and say, I didn't know that?
I mean, there's always idiosyncratic behaviors that, and these are the things that people always want to know, like, why does my cat, why is my cat afraid of cucumbers? You know, that was the big trend last year. And a lot of times we don't necessarily know the answer to the question. It's like, your cat is an individual, just like you are, you do weird things. So yeah, occasionally you do see things and you scratch your head, and without more data, we can't really make a conclusion about what that means for cats overall. We might know that that one particular cat maybe got attention for doing a cute behavior, or for whatever reason, it enjoys a particular behavior, but we don't necessarily learn a lot about cats in general.
You know, I have three friends who are psychiatrists. It's transference. I'm seeing three psychiatrists.
Okay, that was going to be my next question.
Yeah, I think they're my friends. But no, I know three psychiatrists who insist that cats are much more interesting than dogs. Are cats smarter than dogs?
Everyone always wants to compare cats to dogs. Cat people versus dog people. Are cats smarter than dogs? Are dogs nicer than cats? And I see the only thing that they really have in common is that they're the two most popular pets, and they're both predators. But other than that, they have a very different evolutionary history. The reason they became pets is very different. And so I really don't like to compare them. I think cats are very smart. They have evolved to solve certain problems, the main one being how to kill mice. And dogs have been very highly selected through domestication for particular behaviors, which is why you have some dogs that like to fetch and some dogs that maybe like to point and some dogs that like to sit on laps, whereas all cats have kind of just come into our lives to do one thing, which is to control pests.
I do a radio show with Ralph Nader. Yes, I'm bragging. And by the way, Noam Chomsky was on with Ralph.
And, very nice. Yes. I voted for Ralph Nader twice, just FYI. Yeah. So.
Yes, you're even smarter than I imagined. And, you know, I always try to impress Ralph Nader that I know something. We're talking about cats, and I said, you know, cats have not evolved in 10,000 years. And he said, actually, that's not true. And you just kind of reiterated that. I was under the impression, at least for the past year, that they've unraveled the kitty cat genome and they have found that despite man's effort, they could not change cats, that they will not evolve. And so cats who are in your house, are really confused and thinking, what the hell am I doing here? Why am I not in the jungle?
But how did I get stuck living with these strange two-legged beings?
Yeah, but that's not true, Ralph says, and you kind of intimated that cats have evolved.
Well, cats have changed through domestication, you know, and you will hear this debate, are cats domesticated or not? And so kind of the current scientific consensus from experts is like, they're sort of domesticated. We have made some changes to the genome, especially related to memory, fear, and also the recognizing of rewards, which suggests that our domestic cats have a slightly better ability to remember that, hey, this human is a source of food, maybe I should like them. Mm-hmm. But we also know that cats' closest wild relatives, which is the Middle Eastern wildcat, is fairly similar in behavior and also in ability to be tamed if you get them at a young age. So I wouldn't say that we haven't changed cats at all. I mean, 10,000 years is 10,000 years, and we have imposed a few things on cats. So we ask them to live near humans, mm-hmm. and we ask them to be more flexible about living with other cats, because most people who have one cat want at least one more, or maybe mm-hmm. 10 more. So, you know, I think that they do have some flexibility, and some of that is imposed just by socialization and getting them when they're young.
Right.
But they're not completely like bonkers off the wall wild. That right. said, they do have some special needs, and we're not very good at meeting those needs.
Right, so we'll get to that in a second.
So I would say they're semi-domesticated. We have seen some changes. Maybe we'll see more as we continue to selectively breed. But the thing with dogs is that we've done a lot more selective breeding, where we actually choose their mates for them, whereas mm-hmm. most cats get to pick their own sex partners.
So an analog to dogs would be the royal family, right? Most of them look like dogs.
Yeah.
We pick their mates, we breed exactly. them, and they... Are cats crazy?
No. Okay. Humans are.
Okay.
We might make cats crazy, but I don't think cats are crazy. But, you know, they're responding to their environment, and if their environment is poor, then they might have behavior problems.
How many cats is too many cats?
So how many cats is too many cats? It really depends. I've had clients who had a 3-story house and 2 cats was too many. And I've had clients that lived in a very small space and peacefully lived with 5 cats. So I think it really depends on how well the cats know each other, how well they get along, and how well the person can take care of their needs. And so when you have too many cats, that's when you perhaps are not meeting their needs very well. So I'm all for multiple cat households.
Okay.
So
I have a friend who named her cat Simon Feinberg.
Okay.
Is it right to give last names to cats?
Absolutely.
Really?
I mean, I think they should have a middle name because, you know, when you get frustrated, you want to, like when you're a little kid, you know, your parents would suddenly use your first name and your middle name.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good to have a full suite of names. But I find actually most people don't even call their cats by their official names. They tend to have at least 20 nicknames for their cats that okay. are unrelated to their actual name. Does but I think it's acceptable to give a cat a last name.
Okay. Does a cat know it has a name?
So that's a good question. I think cats will respond to a name if you teach them that, hey, when I say your name, I deliver your meals.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that they recognize that I'm Pinky and this is my identity. I think they know when my human says the sound in a certain tone of voice, it means something good will happen.
One of my ex-wives,
you have multiple ex-wives?
Well, I'm not allowed to talk about. But
okay.
we always had 4 cats. That was in our house. Mm-hmm. I think the cats might have been responsible for a lot of problems in the marriage.
That's not uncommon.
Yeah, and always four cats. I was married to a saint, kindest person in the world, but she gave nicknames to our cats, one of whom was named Ginger, but my wife would call her Fatty in front of everybody. Because the
cat. Do you think the cat was humiliated?
Well, is it? The cat was very heavy. So she would just, my wife would unleash invectives. You know, she would say, there's Fatty, here, Fatty, and she'd call her Fatty. And I didn't think it was right. And I'm being serious because I think, especially around kids, you don't call it, you don't fat shame a cat, and you should take responsibility for your indoor cat being fat. What is its, you know, why is your cat fat?
Absolutely. I'd say the first step is helping that cat lose weight so that they're healthy, because obesity in cats, I mean, it might be funny and a lot of people think it's cute, but it can actually cause medical problems like diabetes, joint problems. So the nickname, you know, is it cruel to call your cats, you know, funny names or humiliating names? I don't think it's cruel, but it might reflect some other sentiments you have towards the cat, or it might even color other people's perceptions of the cat. So if you were to suggest that the cat was lazy, then other people might not try to help the cat exercise or play because they just assume because the cat is fatty, he's lazy. So I do think that nicknames can be harmful in that they might color people's opinions about a cat. So if you have a cat who bites and you call them killer, mm-hmm. your friends are going to come over and be like, oh, that's the aggressive cat. And you've already kind of pegged that cat as, you know, difficult.
We came up with a theory because I get, you know, over 30 years, four cats all the time. We must have had, I don't know, 20 cats. We have a theory that black and white cats are the best. And I, from what I understand, they're... are some theories about coloration in cats and their personalities. Is that true?
That is true. Actually, some colleagues and I did a study looking at people's perceptions of personality based on coat color. And what we found actually is that people tended to associate positive terms with orange cats. So you're kind of... stereotypical Garfield appearance, mm-hmm. And we're less likely to say nice things about white cats and tortoiseshell cats. There's another study out of UC Davis, maybe a year or two ago, asking people about their cat's personality traits and behaviors and their cat's coat color, and also suggested that perhaps tortoiseshell cats did present more aggressive behaviors in certain circumstances. So I think we have ideas about coat color and whether or not those cats are nice or not. Some of that, of course, is biased by our own personal experience. Mm-hmm. And I did find when I worked at the animal shelter that people who had had a particular color of cat often came in wanting a cat that basically looked the same as their previous cat. So I think perhaps people put a little too much weight on the appearance, just like we wouldn't want someone to maybe, you know, want to be our friend or date us just because of the color of our hair. I would say get to know the cat as an individual and don't necessarily judge them based on their coat color.
Food puzzle.
Black and white cats are adorable. So
yeah, we've had the best.
They're adorable. I love them.
I had a black. We had Crazy Jerry. By the way, that was, you know, we gave our cats really bad names. We had Crazy Jerry. And Crazy Jerry, I would roll him up into a ball. I'm not making this up. And I would slide him. He would start purring the minute I rolled him up. And I'd slide him across the floor. And then he'd come back to me. And we'd
do play. Not try this at home, folks.
I know. And we would play fetch with him. Mm-hmm. And he just, and it was, we would, you know, eventually he got dizzy. But my kids thought it was the funniest thing in the world. When they're purring, does that mean they're happy and they're enjoying being slid across the floor?
Tortured, you mean?
Is that torture?
No. I mean, you know, rough play with cats is, it can be a dangerous place to go because some cats will get aggressive. I mean, it sounds like he enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. He might have enjoyed other types of play too. So I always encourage people to try different types of play with toys, you know, feather wand, that sort of thing. So, you know, it sounds like he had fun and nobody was hurt and he came back for more. So, yeah, not necessarily torture, but purring is usually a sign of contentment. Sometimes cats will purr when they are injured. And so it's not always positive, but I'd say most of the time it's positive.
Boys play rough with cats, girls don't, correct?
I find that former dog owners like to play roughly with cats, and yes, some men like to play roughly with cats. Whether it's, I mean, I've certainly met women that like to play rough with cats too. I don't advocate using your hand as a toy. Again, this is a predatory animal. They have teeth that are meant to tear apart a rat. They have claws that are meant to disembowel a rabbit. You know, they're weapons. And so when we direct those weapons toward us, it's kind of giving the cat mixed messages, because when you want to pet the cat and have a cuddly moment, do you want them to turn on you and start biting and bunny kicking your arm? Usually not. And then the person gets mad at the cat. The cat's confused, like, hey, it was fine 2 minutes ago. What's your problem? So I'm very much about handling cats consistently and not purposely getting them riled up, because usually those things are something we want and not necessarily what the cat wants. I'm very much, you know, the human should do the cat's bidding.
Is it fair to say that men don't believe in petting cats? They believe in deep tissue massage with cats? Isn't that...
Yeah, I don't know. I think you might be projecting a little bit.
Okay. All right.
But,
fat cats.
Yes.
Food, this is one of the reasons I've called you. Food puzzles for cats. You maintain that the reason cats get fat is because they're being fed too easily, that they're hunters, that they need to hunt for their food, that they wouldn't eat a bowl of mice.
Absolutely. So, yeah, I think part of it is they're being fed too much and they're not being exercised enough. You can exercise cats in other ways, but the nice thing about food puzzles is that they don't require a lot of effort on the part of the owner. And what I found is the less you give the owner to do, the more likely they are to do it.
So give me an example of a food puzzle for a cat.
Sure. There's basically two different types. There's the kind that roll around. So there's something like a slim cat ball, which is basically a ball. It has holes in it. You put a cat's dry food inside. They roll the ball around, and sporadically food will shoot out of the puzzle, and then they can eat the food, play with the ball some more. More food comes out. And then there are stationary puzzles, which are more like a base that has cups, or it might have tunnels, tubes, anything like that, where you put the food inside the tunnels and the tubes, and the cat has to manipulate the food more with their paws. So that's good for cats that are very dexterous, whereas the rolling food puzzles are definitely good for cats that maybe are not as focused on using their paws for interacting with things.
And you can learn more about this by going to Food Puzzles for Cats.
Absolutely. That's a website that my colleague Ingrid Johnson and I put together, basically to give people a resource on how to get started, what types of puzzles there are, and, you know, there's lots of cute videos of cats interacting with these food puzzles. And so if you want to go down a rabbit hole of watching cat videos, you can watch a lot of videos of cats playing with food puzzles, and then you will think it's totally cute, and you will want to do it with your own cats at home, because it's really fun.
I'm a vegetarian.
So am I.
For moral reasons.
Me too.
Why can't cats be vegetarians?
Well, cats are obligate carnivores. You'll hear that a lot. And so, you know, again, looking at what have cats been eating the whole time they have been cats? Rats, birds, mice, snakes, lizards. And so it's only been the last couple hundred years that we have even had cat food. In fact, I think cat food was invented in the late 1800s. So cat food is a relatively new invention. And that really, I think, sped up this process of cats living in our homes, sleeping in our beds, cuddling on our laps. All of this has happened very recently. So what we know nutritionally is that, you know, cats are evolved to eat meat. And if they don't have meat, they are lacking in certain nutrients that can cause heart damage. It can cause blindness. They definitely need taurine, which is only found in meat. And the vegan supplements are questionable, I would say. I'm not a vet, so I don't like to give nutritional advice, but I will say your cat should be eating a meat-based diet. And again, you know, it's like projecting what humans want. Okay, I'm a vegetarian. I would prefer to not feed my cats meat because I'm a vegetarian for moral reasons. But I don't want to impose my beliefs on my cat. And I believe that if I gave my cat a choice between a pile of vegan food and a pile of regular cat food, that they are going to want to eat one and probably not the other.
Is there vegan food for cats?
I think someone's marketed it, but I don't even want to go there.
Let me ask you some difficult questions now.
Okay.
All right.
Bring it on.
All right. Do you believe in evolution?
Absolutely.
Do you believe that there was a time when humans had to kill a living thing to survive?
So I have to say human evolution is not my scientific area of expertise. Have we always lived around plants? I believe so. So I think that there have been periods where humans did eat a lot of meat, obviously, but do I think we were eating other things at the same time? Most likely we were also eating a varied diet with like roots and grasses and tubers.
But yeah. I think that as we've gotten smarter and we understand nutrition, people like me who always choose the path of least resistance will go, okay, you've proven to me that it's safe to live on a vegan diet. I will have a vegan diet now. But mm-hmm. if it couldn't be proven to me, I probably would eat chicken and fish, but it's been presented to me scientifically that I don't need that, and that is a 21st century notion. I think if I lived it, knowing who I am in the 19th century, I would have eaten meat. So my difficult question is this. What if we start putting cats on vegan diets and keep the ones who survive?
They will be blind and have heart disease. So they won't be able to reproduce. I understand the argument you're making. I don't think those are the kinds of changes that we could make in cats overnight. I mean, we have seen that in cats and dogs.
But if we did breed, if we just said,
them?
I'm going to say, could you breed, could I go off to a farm?
Mm-hmm.
And rescue all these cats? These mm-hmm. are difficult questions, but it's going to get mm-hmm. harder as we go along here. I go off to a farm.
This is an ethical test.
I've got some tough questions to ask you now. Okay. I'm going to start a farm, and I'm going to rescue cats, and I'm going to breed vegan cats. And I'm going to have a breed of cats that survive on vegan food. So in other words, I'm going to feed all these cats vegan meals, the ones who live to a ripe old age or look healthy. I will then, with Dr. Mengele at my side, we will pick the ones who are thriving on a vegan diet, and we'll create a super race of kitty cats who don't need to kill.
Those cats are going to be too tired to have sex.
Seriously.
So they won't reproduce.
Seriously?
so you're taking, I mean, I think the...
That's Animal Protective Services calling. They're
exactly
listening to
like,
the show.
Why are you talking to this fool? So you're, you know, I think then do you even have a cat anymore? Like the essence of who a cat is a hunter.
Ah.
And if we can't accept that, then perhaps we shouldn't have them as pets.
Is it true that other than human beings, what am I going to ask you?
Wait, other than human beings?
Phil, you know what I'm going to ask you.
No, I don't know.
Are cats the only other animal that hunt for fun and not for food?
No, I think that any natural predator gets pleasure out of hunting. And so for cats, every part of the hunt is pleasurable. And we know that cats will hunt while they're eating their last kill. One reason is because if you're living outside, you don't know when that next mouse is going to come along. So you have to just take advantage of every opportunity. But we can also assume that cats' brains are evolved, developed to experience pleasure at the various stages of hunting. That's the chasing, that's the chewing, the crunching on the bones. I'm guessing that all of that is fun to cats, and that's why when we see them, quote unquote, playing with their prey, it looks very cruel. And yeah, it's not necessarily fun to watch if you love all animals, which I do, but you know, and by the way, my cats are indoors, so they don't hunt any live animals. They hunt toys. But when we play with them with toys, like a feather wand or a, you know, a cat dancer, we're seeing those same pleasurable behaviors that, you know, the pleasure is triggered by all the different aspects of hunting. So I would say it's fun. And maybe
okay,
it's fun for
I,
us too, right? We play games where we shoot things, right? And we have fun doing it. So maybe it's brain chemistry and something about killing mice is really fun for cats.
I read, and it was in the New York Review of Books, a review of a controversial book about cats that I'm going to get to in a second, that they said that cats are the only other animals besides humans who will hunt on a full stomach and enjoy it and leave the dead carcass, the carcass there by itself, and move on.
I mean, I don't know. I would have to do a little investigating, but I would say for any species that has to survive by hunting, that there has to be a drive for hunting, that unless you hunt something where you are just guaranteed a food source for a long period of time, that you would need to be kind of keeping one eye on your next kill.
Right.
Because, again, you just don't know. It's not like us where we can go to the fridge or, you know, like our pets where we feed them three meals a day. It's
right.
Just a very different kind of survival mindset.
Now, a cat will bring you a mouse, right?
Yes.
And if you don't eat the mouse, you're being rude.
You're not being rude. You can just hide it under your napkin. And then when they're not looking, you scrape it into the trash.
But if you don't eat that mouse, they don't eat it.
Well, they don't eat everything they kill. Again, the instinct to kill is not necessarily entwined with hunger.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, the mouse may have died in vain.
Okay.
Because the cat was practicing killing.
All right, we're going to wrap it up after, but it's going to get hard now.
I'm ready. Just
right.
Bring it on.
Well, this new book that I read about that says...
Which one? Is this the Cat Wars book?
Well, it's the one that says that cats are murderers and they're destroying the planet.
Right, right. And they're killing every bird on the planet.
But more than just birds, you know, rodents who we need for our ecology, that they are just trained to... Not trained. As you said, they're hunters. And they are causing more damage to the planet, I think, than cars, you know, running them over, running animals over. Pesticides, they're more dangerous than pesticides, more dangerous than global warming. That cats,
it's going to be cats that do us in, right?
Well, I mean, but that there's a new theory, at least in this book, that cats are murderers and need to be reined in. Where do you stand on this?
Well, where I stand on it is, you know, some of the science behind that book has been critiqued, and a lot of the reports are based on modeling, so mm-hmm. they're not always. It's not like someone's going out and checking every, you know, rodent and bird that's been killed in a particular transect and being able to like use forensic technology to show, you know, that Fluffy killed this bird and Max killed that mouse. So do cats have an impact on the environment? I would say absolutely. I mean, just like humans do, we live in a very complicated web of interactions between species, and we've screwed that up a lot. First of all, by, you know, having pets, we destroy animals' habitats, and then we drive certain animals into other areas because we want to build housing in them. So, you know, we kill a lot of birds by cutting down trees, deforestation. So I think it's a bigger and more complicated question than just saying, yeah, it's all cats' fault. It's like, yeah, let's just blame the cats. They're cute, but, you know, ultimately, yeah, they're going to kill us off. The reason human civilization will go down is because of cats. That would actually be pretty awesome. but, you know, I think it is a much more complicated picture, and a lot of other scientists will argue that what cats tend to kill are animals that are already weak and probably wouldn't have survived anyway. So you will get arguments on either side. I think the best thing that we can do is, in general, I advocate that people keep their cats indoors or control their outdoor access. I think that's good for the cat, it's good for the environment, and it's good for your neighbors. As someone who has, I live in a neighborhood with a lot of outdoor cats who have, you know, they like to use my garden as a bathroom, so I don't really appreciate that so much. So I think, you know, keeping cats indoors comes with responsibilities, like keeping them entertained, and that's where the food puzzles and the toys come into play.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, recognizing that the human impact on the environment is much more significant. I think we can get really focused on one species, but then, you know, the other problem is if you get rid of the cats, then the rats proliferate, and rats eat birds' eggs. They kill birds. So it's not like you can't just take one piece out of the Jenga puzzle and expect it not to fall over.
You said that cats decided to hunt mice to make themselves attractive to humans.
Well, they didn't decide to, but it worked out. It was mutually beneficial. So when humans settled, we were becoming agricultural. And so we had these large stores of grains that attracted rodents, and that attracted the cats. And so humans don't want rodents eating their grains. So cats show up. They kind of take care of the rodents for us. And then it's like, oh, hey, maybe I should give this cat a little shelter. He's kind of cute and he's helping me out. And then the cat's like, hey, this person's, you know, not so bad. Maybe I should try to get into his house and sleep on the bed.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's kind of the 2-second version of what occurred over 10,000 years, is that we've had this mutually beneficial relationship. And it's only been recently that we've brought cats indoors only. You know, that kitty litter was invented, cat food was invented, and now suddenly cats are, you know, all over the internet. We're basically treating them like babies,
mm-hmm.
instead of like wild animals. And so we've asked a lot of them in a very short period of time. So
would there was a thing I saw, a story about a cute little girl with a bone disease, and how a Great Dane was her walker, that she would go to class leaning on this Great Dane, which is an enormous dog, you know, 5 times the size of this 5-year-old girl. You know, your eyes well up. And it occurred to me that if there were a cat the size of a Great Dane, what are the chances it would eat that girl?
Pretty big, I think. Like, would you let a tiger walk your child to school?
So, is it fair to say that your favorite cats, if they somehow were given a growth hormone, if they got to a certain size, they would treat you they turn you into Roy Horn?
We might be prey to them, yeah, because they're, so cats typically prefer prey that's smaller than a pigeon. I think larger than that, it's difficult for them to kill it.
Do they want to kill us? Do they want to eat us?
No.
Do some of them?
So. No.
You think some? Don't you think some of them?
No, because we are predators of cats. They, you know, we have to earn their trust because we're big and scary. And so the other thing that I think we forget is because we focus so much on cats are the predators, they're killers, but they're also prey animals, and that's why you have this kind of scaredy cat stereotype. You know, cats have to be always looking for their next meal, but they're also making sure that there's not a dog, a coyote, a hawk that's, you know, a human that is going to turn around and wipe them out. So they kind of live in this in-between space. Now, if we were small and they were huge, I think that we would probably trigger hunting behavior in them. So,
and cats always leave a little food in the bowl.
Not mine.
Really?
Well, some cats do. I have one cat who leaves food behind, but the other one would just keep going.
Oh, all our cats left a little food in the bowl.
Maybe you're feeding them too much.
Can you train a cat to use the toilet?
You can, but why would you want to do that?
Because it's funny.
Yeah,
why wouldn't you?
Yeah, because, I think if I believed that cats experienced humiliation, then being forced to go to the bathroom on a toilet might be that. But I know I'm like kind of a broken record with the cat as a predator and their natural behavior and background, but, you know, cats scratch and cover their waste for a reason. And that served a function for them when they were wild animals, and that was to cover their tracks. And so when cats cannot go in a sandy type substrate that they can cover their scent, we're creating a situation where they're like, oh crap, someone might find me. And so that can be stress inducing. I don't think a toilet is particularly comfortable for a cat.
But they do. There are some cats who just do that naturally.
There are some cats that just do it naturally. And if they do it naturally, you know, that's fine. But to force a cat to do that, I think is asking for, it's asking for a cat that's going to crap on your bed.
Okay.
And, that's my advice.
And do cats have IQs? I mean, can you determine whether or not one cat is smarter than the other?
No one has done like a standardized cognitive test in cats. There's actually a scientist who's done some of this work in dogs. There's a few scientists actually, like, you know, dognition is very, or dog cognition is a very hot topic in science right now. And so I think that cat IQ tests are probably, you know, 5 years from now, there will be a cat IQ test and we'll be looking at basically problem solving differences in cats. I think, you know, again, most cats would be able to solve the one important problem to them, which is killing a mouse. But, you know, we want to know, can cats count? Do they recognize my voice? Do they know when I point at something that I want them to go to it? Can they learn tricks? So that's kind of how we judge intelligence, right? We kind of judge it on our own intelligence.
Mm-hmm. So you're from San Francisco and Berkeley, which is the home of Starbucks and Pete's Coffee. Have you ever had Pete's Coffee?
You know, I don't drink coffee. I drink tea.
Okay.
Why?
Well, here's one of the things I noticed.
Does it have to do with cats?
Yeah. And I want to know if any of my listeners have experienced this. Always have four cats. I've had cats before the advent of Starbucks and Pete's Coffee. That's like, you know, 1990, 93, 94 is when Americans really started drinking good coffee. And one of the things I notice is that I like strong coffee, and I'll put the coffee down on the kitchen table, and the cats who would get up on the table, which they're not supposed to do, would try to would make the motion of bearing my coffee. Has that ever happened? Go ahead.
What did you put in your coffee?
Poo and pee. No,
okay.
No.
Creamer?
Black
coffee. You drank
it black. Black coffee. And ever since then, my mind plays tricks on me. I've decided that coffee has a urine smell to it.
It's possible. I mean, chemically, it could have some sort of structure that is similar to urine or even food. I mean, cats will cover food as well if they're, you know, you'll see cats scratching around the food bowl. And so that the idea is that, okay, they don't want anyone else to find that. So they're trying to hide their tracks. It's probably something along those lines. I was going to say, if you put like creamer in your coffee, maybe the fat was attractive and they thought.
But let me explain. I want to know if my listeners have experienced this. What the cat is doing is about a hot steaming cup of black coffee. It walks up to the mug. And this is several cats have done this. And it just rubs its paws against the kitchen table as though it's bearing the coffee, but there's no dirt. I mean, I'm a slob, but it's not that bad.
This sounds like a YouTube video waiting to happen.
But it's like a phantom vestigial motion that accomplishes. So what is it? Why are they doing that? It's an instinct?
It's an instinct. So again, they're covering something that they think is going to give them away. And it's not like they're thinking about it, but their instinct, you know, so again, evolution has supported that whatever cats cover their waste or cover their mm-hmm. food or their traces are less likely to get eaten by a predator. Right. Those cats survive, so that behavior continues. And so the behaviors that they perform don't always seem to have a function to us, but they may have served a function in not so distant history, or they might serve a function if they were outside, not sitting on your kitchen table like they weren't supposed to. And that's something that I could help you with. But
okay. Last question, and then you'll come back. Was this okay?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
Last question. Favorite cat. How many cats have you had?
In my lifetime?
Yeah.
We had a revolving door of cats when I was a child that didn't live that long because I lived in a pretty rural area. Cats went outside, got hit by cars.
You know, but before you answer that question,
yeah.
There is a theory among people like me who have had way too many cats in their lives that, you know, a cat belongs outside and maybe it won't live that long, but it'll be much happier.
Mm-hmm.
What are your thoughts on that?
I think cats can be perfectly happy indoors. Do I think that cats experience some things outside that make them happy? Sure. For me personally, I've decided that it's not worth the risks. I don't feel like I live in a neighborhood where it's safe to go outside. And, you know, again, as I said before, like neighborhood cats can be a problem. And so I think part of being a responsible neighbor may mean keeping your cats indoors. And so my focus is always like, how can we make the indoors fun for our cats?
Mm-hmm.
And so they're not
right.
just sleeping all day and like being lazy, but they can look out the window and watch birds. So having a bird feeder outside, they have toys to play with. They have to work for their food. They get attention from me. They have a heated bed to lay on. So making sure that they have an environment inside that is enriching and stimulates all of their senses, their sense of smell. They can
right.
chew on cat grass or, you know, smell through an open window. So I don't see it as cats can only be happy outdoors.
And you can learn more about that, how to accomplish that for your cat, by going to felineminds.com or Food Puzzles for Cats. Favorite cat? Is it okay to have... You can't have
so
a
favorite? You want me to pick one of my cats as my favorite?
Yeah.
That's cruel.
Really?
Yeah, I mean...
You don't have an all-time favorite cat?
It's hard to say. I had this one cat. He was really awesome. He was a chronic masturbator, and he... he had this really big personality. He, like anytime we'd have a party, he was, you know, he walked through the lasagna. He sat on my roommate's birthday cake. He was always just doing things to kind of get attention, and it was just who he was. So he was definitely... a very big presence in my life. And when he died, I was devastated and cried every day for like 2 months.
What was his name?
Kittums.
Kittums. It's interesting. The difficult ones are our favorites, aren't they?
Yeah. I mean, and so at the time I had another cat whose name was Jesus. And Jesus had kind of a mellow personality. He was, I don't want to call him boring. He was very sweet. But, you know, he was just kind of a little wallflower who just wanted, you know, a couple of cuddles and just chill on the couch. But yeah, the ones I think that are more interactive.
You named
with
a cat
us.
Jesus.
I did.
I thought my mother thought I was God. Jesus.
I thought it was funny at the time. You know, I will admit I'm an atheist, and when mm-hmm. I was a teenager, I mean, so I got him when I was like 18, and I was living in this kind of punk house with a bunch of boys, and we mm-hmm. and my cats at the time went outside, and so we thought it was hilarious that we were yelling out the front door for Jesus. So we just thought our neighbors would be mortified. So I think at the time I thought it was very funny.
He turned water into a very nasty smell that is hard to get off your couch.
Yeah, exactly.
How do you get rid of the smell of urine?
Enzymatic cleaners that are made for cat urine.
Okay. My favorite cat, and then I'll let you go. My favorite cat was Sammy. And when I would sneeze, he'd go, meow.
Oh, that's so cute.
It was bizarre. Michael Maria yes. Delgado is a certified cat behavior consultant. And if you're having problems with your cat, you should go to felineminds.com and contact Michael Maria Delgado. And you will analyze the cat?
For a fee.
Okay.
Yeah, we offer consulting services, mostly in the Bay Area, but we do remote consultations as well. So, we mostly deal with problems like litter box avoidance and difficulties introducing new cats, cats
so you're,
keeping
you're,
people
you're,
up all night.
You're a cat shrink, right?
I you could call it that. More often than not, a lot of the work is changing the human's behavior.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of give and take in living successfully with a cat, as you probably know, since you've lived with a lot of them.
I would send one of my cats to see you, but I don't want my cat on the couch, and I don't want them seeing a psychiatrist because they're on the couch. That's a bad joke.
Michael, how do
people contact you?
They can email info@felineminds.com. That's probably the best way, or through my blog, catsandsquirrels.com.
Great. Thank you, Michael.
You're welcome.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.